welcome our speaker this afternoon, Fergus McCabe. He has come to talk to you about his experiences, vast experiences, really working in the North Inner City and in the Greater Dublin area. Fergus has been a community activist for a very long period of time. He's been specifically involved in campaigns against drugs in Dublin, and most recently you may have seen Fergus being interviewed on television news about efforts at regenerating the North Inner City. So he's come today to talk about his experience on the ground, as it were, in Dublin, and Fergus was saying that he's going to kind of talk in steps in terms of different aspects of his work, and he's more than happy for you to sort of engage with each chunk as you go along.
Okay. Yep.
You're very welcome.
Okay, so thanks very much, Owen. Thanks for the invitation to be here today. I'm really very happy to come down and talk with you all, and thank you guys for coming along. As I said, my name is Fergus McCabe, and I've been involved in some way or the other in the North Inner City area, Dublin, for now, for over 50 years or so. And my involvement has been at a number of different levels. It's been as initially as a volunteer in a youth club in near Sean McDermott Street in the centre there. After that, I was employed by the old Dishton Health Board as a community worker. I'll talk a bit about that. Then I worked as a project leader in the Neighbourhood Youth Project, and I remember many years ago there used to be one in South Hill, but I think it disappeared somewhere along the line. And then I was involved as a campaigner at different levels. I was involved in issues around drugs, urban development, and I was on a number of national things, and I'm still involved with national drugs policy and so forth, on a couple of other different things on crime and urban poverty and so forth. So I have a lot of experience of working with different issues, both from the level of working on the ground and trying to work with groups of people to try and bring about change in communities. And the communities are primarily the communities who, over the years, the ones who have resided in the North Inner City, but also through the drugs, obviously citywide and nationally, with groups of people who are campaigning on the drugs issue on a national level. So what I wanted to do was to look at issues of social regeneration and community development, kind of maybe under kind of four themes, going back 60s, 70s in the North Inner City, which would be like community development, protest and politics. I'd be looking at how Tony Gregory and the thing called the Tony Gregory Deal came into play, and how it was facilitated by community development of the North Central Community Council. So that's 60s, 70s, then 70s, 80s into the 90s. If you're looking at the response of community groups locally and networks to the drugs issue. The 80s, the Concerned Parents Against Drugs. In the 90s, a group called ICON, Citywide, and the Coalition of Communities Against Drugs. So the first one is about urban development, community development, the second one about drugs. The third issue I want to look at is the issue of migration within the context of young people. So for example, in the services in the North Inner City, as in other parts of Dublin, and indeed it's almost telling me all over the country, there will be an increased number of people, and young people in particular, from different countries, and how groups responded to that, how they responded to the existing policies or lack of policies, how they responded to the needs of young people, how they tried to involve young people who are from new communities in getting engaged. And then the final one is the one Owen just mentioned. Currently there's a sort of a campaign on in the North Inner City to negotiate with the government about a new approach. And that nearly brings us back to where we started, in the sense of in 1982, a thing called the Gregory Deal called for a thing called an Inner City Authority. And for a short period, that looked like it was going to be delivered on, and then it fell away. And we're in a way, we're nearly back to where we started. So I am obviously completely not our bias, because I'm involved with all of these things. So, I mean, again, I'm coming from a perspective of somebody who is a practitioner. So there are other voices you probably need to hear. I mentioned a couple of maybe independent sources that you can check out whether I'm accurate or not about, or another version on all these things that happen. Well, I'll start saying with the North Inner City. The North Inner City of Dublin, which is basically from O'Connell Street and four or five parishes around there, back through the 60s was becoming an area where there was huge unemployment. It was also an area where the major housing organisation, Dublin City Council, began to use certain parts of it if people were unable to pay their rent and so forth. They began to use it, like in some parts of the North Inner City, as a punishment zone. There were disconnects between a lot of the policy makers or the organisations that were supposed to be running the inner city. So there was no real authority about what happened in relation to housing, employment, social services, etc. They were all kind of run independently of each other, which is the same in many cases still in many places. But in those days it was even more pronounced. There was very little in the way of local community organisation. By that I mean tenants or community groups. You had a huge population, primarily of people who'd been resident there for quite a significant number of time, many of them very large families. Most of the housing was old 19th century tenement blocks and so forth. So in terms of the first real look at that, there was a report brought out in 1974 called The Inner City of Dublin by UCD, the Department of Psychiatry, had a community development division, because a guy called Ivor Brown, who some of you may or may not heard of, but Ivor Brown was the chief psychiatrist, he was the chief in UCD of the department. He was also the guy with responsibility for major psychiatric institutions like St. Brendan's and so forth. So he's a very powerful guy, but he had a community development division. And him and that division were the first to come with a series of information. And basically the report that they brought out in 74 said what? It said that the North Inner City has the highest levels of unemployment, the highest levels of physical and mental ill health, the highest levels of environmental decay, the worst levels of educational achievement. It says the kids were leaving school at that stage, 14 was the age. So across a whole range of things, education, housing, environment, employment, etc., the conclusion was the North Inner City is significantly disadvantaged. It also stated that there was no existent government responses, so there was no existent policies there to try and address disadvantage. So that was one thing. The situation, as outlined by them, was this. Within those communities, as I say, there wasn't very much local organisation. There were one or two tenant groups that had been set up by a thing called NATO, which was the National Association of Tenants Organisations, not the North Atlantic Treaty organisation. So they had one or two, but very few. So when I was employed as a community worker, my first job was to link in with groups of local people and try and see that they want to form their own organisation within blocks of flats or within streets, etc. So from 73, 74, 75, I was involved with that. Alongside me, there were other people. There was Mick Rafferty, there was Chrissy Mangan, there were a number of different women. So in different parts of the area, there were different people who had either were involved in tenants groups that were there or were involved in some of the groups I was setting up or had set up groups. So by about the time that the Inner City report came out, there was a network, and the network was called the North Central Community Council. Now, the North Central Community Council, which had representatives from all the smaller tenants' blocks, etc., began to look at then some of the issues that the Ivor Brown's report had identified. And they began then to talk to, or try to talk to, the state agencies about some response. Having said that, the major issue that mobilised the people in all the blocks of flats when I was trying to set them up weren't the bigger issues, employment, education and so forth. They were simple things like house maintenance, like rubbish collection, like the state of the flats, like stuff. And that was the issue that initially. But when people got organised around those issues, then they moved on. So for example, one of the other things that from a meeting at the Summer Hill Tenants Association, there was a school right beside it, called Rutland Street School, which had a terrible reputation. It was a primary school. Many of the kids went there, but it was a school that hadn't got trained teachers because teachers wouldn't work. was seen as a ghetto school, a sink school, kids often ran kind of wild in it and so forth. An offshoot of the Summerhill Tenants was the Ruffin Street School Action Committee. So groups of local people were beginning to get engaged with addressing some of the issues beyond just the day-to-day issues of maintenance and rubbish. They began to look at issues like education. Again, this was all happening at a time when the government initially had many plans, but for those who, there's a book for the broader picture of what was happening in Dublin in the 70s in urban areas, Dermot Ferrier, the historian, and wrote a book, The Ambiguous Republic, Ireland in the 1970s. And he goes into great detail about the overall government plans about, you know, moving people from town to Ballymun and so forth, the whole notion of moving people from the centre. So the way the North Inner City was caught up with that, there had been, as I say, a huge decline in the traditional educational base in the 60s. The containers had gone, containerisation had got rid of the unskilled jobs, increased numbers of unemployment. There was an increase in crime. The area was environmentally looked very bad. And yet now that there was a sort of a decline in that, the government decided to say that maybe the inner city could be reimagined as a financial services, as a place where you could bring in investors. The land, of course, if this was going to be the case, became very valuable. So the general idea, the plan was that you would get rid of a lot of the old tenement buildings and that you would then move the bulk of the majority of the people out of the North Inner City, and you'd replace with some good housing and some new housing, but the bulk of people would have to leave. Such a plan would never, ever, ever be remotely imaginable in an area other than the North Inner City that the government would consider that they could do that. They could say to people who've lived in there often for generations, we are going to do it. When I say the plan, at that stage, when we were setting up the community associations and the tenants groups, the relationship between those of us who were involved in that and some of the state organisations, maybe like the police or the Dublin Corporation, was not one of cooperation, it was one of conflict. There was huge resentment that people were organising themselves among many of the people within some of the state organisations. That's something that isn't, isn't just something that happens in Ireland, it's happened in many places. But the change between now, for those, obviously now, if you look at every single state organisation, they talk about customers, they talk about clients, they talk about citizens' charters, they talk. In those days, there was absolutely nothing like that. So for example, when they talked about consultation, the consultation was they held a public meeting in the hall of John McDermott Street. They sent out leaflets for people to go or not to go. They didn't consult with any of the existing formalised tenants groups, but just invited people on an individual basis. And they presented the plan that was the plan. There was not a case of that there was going to be talk about it. Now, at the time, again, that sort of lack of consultation was helped by the fact that in the mid-70s in Dublin, Dublin Corporation, which was the elected councillor, was disbanded and a kind of commissioner was put in place. So the facilitation of this, if there had been councillors, maybe that made that much more drastic approach might not happen. But anyway, so the plan was there. So naturally enough, you have your plan, you have now your organised communities. So over the 3 or 4 years from the time the plan was announced in the 76, 77, there was a huge issue. So what did the community groups do? Well, they tried to come up with alternatives. The first approach was to try and let's see, can we compromise? Let's see, can we? So again, there was a thing about getting alternative architects and using people like Ivor Brown to get facilities. So we came up. So the community came up with an alternative plan. So instead of knocking down all the blocks of flats and the old tenement buildings, the alternative plan was about renovating. Was it going to cost more? Yeah, certainly it was. But it was going to create a different style of living in the inner city. One of the things within the plan was that it was a plan that included, yes, family homes, that the buildings wouldn't be all one size, one or two, that there would be a mix. So you could cater for all elderly people, you could cater for married people, you could cater for single people. There was a different approach. So the campaign over a number of years went on this, that the community groups were doing this, and around it there were public meetings, there were consultations, there were protests, there were pickets, there were protests on the streets. Some of us got arrested, some of us went to jail, we protested again. Anyway, so you had all this going on, and did it make much of a difference? No, not really. The powers went on with their plan, and the plan went forward until around the same time as all this was happening, one of the people involved, who was the secretary of the North Central Community Council and who was the chair of the Ballybock Tennis Association, decided he would enter politics as a councillor. So we went forward in 79, he got elected. The interesting thing about the electoral register in the area at the time was that often the existing parties, which were primarily Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael, Labour had one TD there, but he subsequently joined Fianna Gael. So it was, if you were talking on a left-right divide, if those things may mean anything, it was a very right-wing elected group of politicians that were there. And that makes a difference from today, where of the candidates in the last time, the same constituency, 70% were kind of left-wing and 30% were right-wing. And those days was completely the reverse. But the interesting thing with Tony Gregory ran was that in one of the wards, the main ward round just behind O'Connell Street, Malva Street, where there was a voting station, 600 people were on the electoral register for the council election in 74. He wasn't running in 74. 600 people, 4 people voted. There was a massive disenfranchisement among the blocks of flats, the tennis groups in the area. The constituency obviously was bigger than the actual North Inner City, but among the tenants and the groups in that area, there was very little political engagement. So Tony Gregory ran, and to run, he talked to all the tenants groups, he talked to the North Central Community Council. Now, he didn't run as the North Central Community Council because the group respected that there were other people who supported Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael and Labour and other parties, but they did support him running as a community candidate. He got elected. And then he ran in 1982 for the general election. 81, there was a general election, he didn't get in. 82, because there was another quick election, he got in. When he got in, he had the balance of power, in the sense that Fianna Fáil and Fine Gael both needed his vote, along with actually Jim Kemmy from Limerick and 3 workers' parties. But they needed a vote. The workers' party decided to abstain and didn't. Jim Kemmy decided not to get to support the existing government. And Tony Gregory and the North Central Community Council people decided to negotiate. And what came out of that was a thing called the Gregory Deal. The Gregory Deal was an agreement between Tony Gregory and Charles Haughey, who was the Taoiseach at the time, in relation to the inner city. It wasn't just in relation to inner city. And one of the interesting things, there was a programme on the radio there about Owen Murphy, I think it's Owen Murphy, a historian, UCD, was sort of saying that in a way it was a national deal. And it was a national deal because within it, not only was it about supporting the rebuilding of extra houses in the North Inner City instead of having very few houses, it opposed the building of a motorway, which was part of the government's plan. It also had a whole range of issues, ranging from environmental issues, lead and petrol, no motorways, to national issues, which included stuff that if it had been ultimately implemented, would have saved the state millions and would have improved people's lives. So it included things like inspection of homes, of children's homes, of old homes, setting up a national children's council, looking at the issue of divorce, a whole range of progressive social issues, plus housing issues, plus taxation, call for a regeneration of the banks, all stuff that's happened maybe 30 or 40 years later and in many ways bad. But anyway, the point was that Charles Haughey, to get elected, needed Tony Gregory's vote. Tony Gregory, backed by the North Central Community Council and a list of specific demands, eventually went and supported Haughey. Haughey got in, and the things that before the state said were impossible to happen were suddenly possible. They agreed to an inner city authority, they agreed to set do with the housing, they agreed. They not only agreed that, they said it was their policy all along, which was utter bullshit. that's what happened. Now, of course, what happened subsequently was that the Haughey government collapsed, because Haughey was probably one of the most corrupt in some ways politicians. He had a lot of skills, but unfortunately, fundamentally, so his government went out. So what was achieved? Well, what was achieved was, number one, the motorway never happened. Number two, the housing did happen. A lot of the broader social issues didn't happen, and one of the things that didn't happen was the inner city authority was not set up. But the lesson for the community groups at the time was that often it isn't about the rationale, it isn't about the justice of your cause, it isn't about how well you promote your redevelopment plan. And if somebody came from Mars, or somebody, professor came from New York or anywhere, who was independently to examine the plan that the community in conjunction with the UCD had come up with versus the corpo plan, they'd opt for the plan that the community came up with, because it was far more comprehensive, it was far more looking at already at that stage, at the time the government, the Irish government at that stage were proposing this stuff about knocking down the inner city. In every other city in Europe, from London to Birmingham to everywhere, they'd already decided that approach wasn't. And in actual fact, the knocking down the Ballymun recently in the towers was one of the things that they had proposed, building up areas like Ballymun. This was the answer. And of course, as we discovered many years later, that was not the answer. The answer was, I would argue, what we were proposing. But anyway, the lesson learned was, number one, is that often, unless you're organized, unless you make a stand, unless you have your facts and your figures and you do come up, I'm not arguing against rationality, but I'm saying you have to have them, but you also then, at the end of the day, ultimately, it can become about power and how you can influence things. So, the first one was the North Central Community Council, and I'll stop with that one quickly, and if anyone wants to throw in anything about that. Outside of the, as I say, the other one, the other, Dermot Fairher's book on Ireland in the 70s goes into a lot about the urban development and the particular issues that I've talked about. The other thing is the Department of Psychiatry, the UCD 1974 report, that's available online. And there's another good one by Joe Lee, the historian. He wrote Politics and Society in Ireland from 1900 to 1985, and he goes into detail. And Joe Lee, who, you know, I always kind of think is a kind of a conservative guy, because I'm a lefty. But anyway, I think Joe Lee was the fairest one, and he's talked about the Gregory Deal. And a lot of people gave out about it and said, oh, the Gregory Deal is just for the North Inner City. Why should the North Inner City get more than anybody else? Why should blah, blah, blah? Okay, well, the answer to that, my answer was, number one, it was the most disadvantaged area. Secondly, it wasn't to do with the inner city. It was to do the capital of Dublin. It was to do with coming up with humane, progressive, decent ways of enabling people to live in peace within their own community. And ultimately, it was good for this capital, it was good for the country if we did this. So I always felt Joe Lee, his take on it was, said it wasn't disgraceful. The Gregory Deal wasn't what was disgraceful. It was disgraceful that it took a Gregory Deal to draw attention to the huge human and social problems of the North Inner City. So that's my bias on it. I agree with Joe Lee in it. So that was the first bit in terms of those days. Lack of organisation ends up protesting at certain levels, but ends up also trying to come up with an alternative. Ends up with a political scenario where a lot of the programme is proposed to be implemented, but ends up finally with some of it being implemented. But the main thing was that a much larger proportion, a couple of hundred houses, and which meant thousands of people who wanted to stay in the inner city could stay. So overall, I probably regard the period as successful in terms of the community development element of. Okay. So anyone want to throw any questions on that before we move on to drugs?
We're okay to move on?
Move on?
Yeah.
Okay, right. So alongside of one of the issues that we talked about was unemployment and all the social issues that were there in the North. North Inner City, and again, a lot of those issues, but maybe not to the same extent. As I said, the facts and the figures outlined by UCD, the UCD report, were not matched anywhere in the country. So you have these ongoing issues. One of the things, but in the 70s, because I worked as a community worker, but I also worked in youth work, one of the things in the 70s was that we'd be hearing about America, and we'd be looking at places like New York and other cities in America, and we'd be hearing about ghettos and drugs and heroin. And we'd be saying, well, that's not here. And it wasn't. I mean, even drug use in the North Inner City in the 70s, the drug use was alcohol. That's the drug use still is. And I have to say, as someone who's involved in policy, let me say for the start, Ireland's biggest and most serious drug issue is alcohol. This is like a confession, I'm a binge drinker. Anyone in Ireland of my age practically drinks too much, and I've been far too tolerant about it. Alcohol is the biggest issue. However, in relation to illegal drugs, the North Inner City had some people smoking cannabis, but not many. And it wasn't even as much as there might have been in places like Trinity or UCD. The amount was quite small with the young people we work with. Alcohol, I say, would have been the main one. But that all changed. In the space of a number of years, from about the late 70s to about the early 80s, heroin became a massive problem. So on top of all the other social problems that I indicated earlier, like housing, unemployment, and so forth, you now had a massive heroin issue. The best report on that at the particular time, brought out around the time, was a report in 1982 that was done by Professor John Bradshaw and Paul Lavelle, the curate, and they produced a report, Drug Use in Dublin Central, 1982. And they also did a 5-year review of it then in about 87, where they came back to look at where it was then. But in 82, what they said, basically they said was that Dublin's inner city has a heroin problem that matches those of the stuff we'd seen in the newspapers or on television, places like America, that heroin would come in. And those of us on the ground could see that. I talked about the Gregory Deal. One of the processes, the Gregory Deal, was a group of us meeting with Charlie Hawley and his ministers at different times when he was still in power. And at the start of the meeting, drugs was on the agenda, but it was way down. But within a period of 7 months, people were, you know, really at their wits' end about how it would be addressed. Because, as I say, it turned family against family. It created a scenario where, you know, I'm not saying that the blocks of flats were utopian or everyone lived happily in peace, but there was very little crime within the flats, on people living within the flats, by people within the flats. That changed with the heroin. The level of violence changed with the heroin. The fact that some people living in the blocks of flats were selling heroin to other people created huge inter-area problems. So in the 80s, this new thing came. By the middle of the 80s into the late 80s, it was a huge, huge problem, and most people would have said it was number one. A group was set up across the city called the Concerned Parents Against Drugs, CPAD. And again, there's a lot of stuff on the net about the Concerned Parents Against Drugs. They had different branches in different areas. In the North Inner City, the Concerned Parents Against Drugs had a mixture of concerned parents, many of them the people who'd been involved in the Central North Central Community Council, people from tenants groups, you'd block local politicians right across the board, you'd politicians from the left and the right, you'd priests, you'd youth workers. So it was a very broad coalition. In other areas it wasn't. And some of the people involved in the Concerned Parents Against Drugs, both in the North Inner City and other areas, were paramilitaries. Some of them were interested in other issues beyond trying to solve the drugs problem. In my opinion, and I can't go into the details of the politics of it, that the Concerned Parents Against Drugs overwhelmingly was a good movement, but in some cases, some of the people within it were too extreme and adopted the path of vigilantism. So there were marches on homes and people were thrown out, etc. in some areas. In town, that didn't happen. Yes, there were marches, people weren't thrown out, there were marches in people's homes. The people who were selling drugs. There were public meetings where people stood up to drug dealers, some of whom had guns and were the same as some of the guys who were still around, and it took a lot of political bravery to do that. And again, Tony Gregory was one of the foremost at doing that, and he raised the issue in the Dáil. Because, why? Because the people who are responsible for the government of the North Inner City effectively reneged on the basic duty of the state for lots of people in various blocks of flats. They couldn't live in peace, their children were threatened, they were threatened, there was massive intimidation, and there was blatant disregard of of the state's own rules. So many of the drug dealers in the early, in the 80s and the early, were living in corporation flats, were on the medical card, were receiving social welfare, and were driving big cars, and were going on holidays to Spain, and so forth. So not only had you a scenario where there was people's children were getting sick, some of them were intimidated then because they weren't able to pay for the drugs, some of them were getting involved in crime, and the community might deal with that, but they couldn't deal with then the thuggery and so forth. And people would say, go to the police. But what would the police do? And if the police did anything, the people who reported would get in trouble. And that's still an issue going on today. I might talk about it later. So, again, the concerned parents did its best in the march, but they weren't making much success, and eventually the concerned parents raveled out of control in lots of areas because they got into vigilantism and some of them were arrested, and it lost. At the time, I always felt the Minister of Health at the time, Barry Desmond, and the government at the time, which was Fine Gael Labour government, missed a huge opportunity of trying to work with community groups on the ground in terms of addressing it. But they didn't take up that opportunity, and there was a very much conflictual relationship between the community groups and the state, which resulted in very little action. And most of the action that occurred at the level of the treatment, not the supply end, the treatment end. In the sense, a lot of voluntary organisations over time began to respond. Some groups on the ground that the North Central community set up, some youth groups that tried to deal with and tried to take kids away. It was a massive problem, which is still ongoing today, that started then, because many of the young people, because of the lack of information, because the fact that it hadn't happened before in Ireland, because the fact that there wasn't treatment, many of the young people ended up with HIV, many of them ended up with AIDS. And to this day, there are a number of children and young people whose parents died all those years ago because of the fact that there wasn't enough responses by the state. By the 90s, the issue was still going on. There had been some movement, as I say, in terms of treatment. But again, because of the fact that we talked earlier on about the redevelopment of the North Inner City, despite the fact that the Gregory Deal had resulted in some of the houses being kept, some projects being kept, there was a massive knocking down, redevelopment of the area. That resulted in many of the old blocks of flats being replaced, much of the social infrastructure, the groups that ran the summer programme, the groups that ran the football for the boys and girls in the summer and did different things, many of them were no longer there because the actual physical places where they were represented were no longer there. Some of the people moved out because there was a 3-4 year plan. So some of even the most, the leaders of the campaign against the redevelopment of the place had to leave because for the sake of their families, that the place was a building site that was noisy, messy and so forth. So the area had changed. The North Central Community Council kind of disappeared. So by the 90s, there was the remnants of the community groups. There was a number of projects, youth projects primarily, and there are a number of voluntary organisations involved with drug. And they came together and formed a new network called the Inner City Organisations Network, or ICON. And again, ICON is on the net, and they have a lot of stuff about the history and a lot of stuff about what they did. But basically, ICON then came together, a group, it was a public meeting, people came together, people were invited to the blocks of flats, and we said, look, this is a new attempt, and the purpose of ICON is to look at the inner city and how we can develop policies. They held public meetings, again, in all the different parishes and the churches. Some of the meetings were packed, some of the meetings had less people than we have in this room. Everyone identified two key issues, youth unemployment and drugs. So what was ICON's response to the drugs issue? They had a three-pronged response. They set up a drugs working group and they were consisted of whom? Of community workers, youth workers, residents, and individuals who lived in the area that weren't part of a community group. And the three-pronged approach was as follows. One was a reinvention of the street campaign, which was holding public meetings in the area, inviting everybody to discuss the drugs problem. That was one approach. The other approach was to lobby government. So that was about sitting down and getting academics, maybe if Owen was in Dublin or Martin there, would get on to them and say, look, can you tell us about best practice elsewhere? One was the lobbying and research and trying to come up with alternatives. And the third approach was an attempt to say, okay, how would any of us in this room here, we have a major problem in a defined geographic area, how do we deal with it? So the Interagency Drugs Project was set up. And the idea of that was to say, okay, the first thing you do is you'd say, okay, here's the coppers, Owen is in, the health board, they're in, the community, they're in. Who else do we want in? Well, who's involved? Maybe the corporation, because they deal with housing and so forth. So the thing was, we identified all the key players, we invited all the key players together, and eventually, after much discussion, it was agreed that the problem was that the guards were dealing with the policing. The health board was dealing, if they were dealing at all, with treatments. The community wasn't involved, with the exception of having to deal with the bad side effects in general. And some of the other groups, the corpos housing and the corpos approach, wasn't linked in with the other. So it was agreed to try and come up with a type of coordinated approach. Ultimately, this thing, which was the IADP, became the model for the local drugs task forces that was set up under the Rabbit report in 76, and I'll talk about that in a minute. So all this activity was involving local people, projects, people within projects, etc. I believe some of you are in new projects, etc. So, I mean, again, the motivation was obviously the people from the community were living with a terrible problem, so they were motivated. The guards were motivated because one of the things I forgot to mention was that, say, during the time of the Concerned Parents Against Drugs, guards were not allowed at the meetings. Health board people weren't allowed at the meeting because the general feeling among the community was that they failed. When we started holding the public meetings with ICON, we changed that dependent on people's field. So, for example, some policemen had got engaged, some policemen had made a genuine effort, they were allowed in. There was a guy called John Fitzgerald, a policeman, and he was allowed in because he'd actually worked on the ground and people felt. So there was a bit of a different approach about trying to get people together to do it. The interesting thing was that the street campaign, and we were talking earlier about media, the street campaign, which involved public meetings in the church, which usually had the format of people saying what the issue was in their own area and what the problems were, followed by maybe a speaker from the guards or maybe a speaker from a university saying, well, there's good practice in England or New York that we might adopt. They were kind of rational. However, naturally, because of the anger and the angst that Fergus got up and started cursing and roaring and screaming and saying we should burn the house down. So of course, whenever the media covered it, it was community calls for coppers to be burned or whatever. It was sensation. The coverage was always sent. They didn't talk about the women who said, okay, we're buying methadone for our sons and daughters, or we're trying to buy methadone and we want to work with the state. They didn't do anything. So the media coverage generally tend to be sensationalist, and this is an issue, I think, for a huge amount of the work whenever it gets confrontational, that the media take a stand. They like to emphasize the sensational as opposed to the rational. So that was a key issue, and then the media were sometimes, people wanted to ban the media and so forth. But anyway, so the three prongs, as I say, the street campaign, some people were queasy about. I mean, there were priests and social workers and youth workers like me. I was working with kids who were selling drugs. I was working with kids who were using drugs. We explained to them that it wasn't vigilantism, that we were looking, that the ICON rallying cry was not pushers out or burn pushers. The rallying cry was pushers beware, addicts we care. And we tried to make the point always, this wasn't about attacking drug users. This was about getting better treatment, better facilities for drug users. And yes, saying to pushers, you've got to stop doing it, you've got to do it because it's impacting on your community. So there's a bit of a difference in emphasis between different groups and different areas. Some were much more let's be told. And again, within the inner city, the challenge within the community development approach about principles, about involving people, but also about respect and fairness and human rights, was also that there were people who wanted to go and burn down the flats. And we said, but look, but there's kids on top of this. There's also kids who are innocent involved in this. And you have to, yes, you can show the community doesn't approve of this. Yes, you can name and shame, but you can't. There was a huge conflict. And at a public meeting, and I remember, you know, on the meeting, when people were so angry sometimes at meetings, that if one of the leaders had said, let's march out down to Fergus's house and wreck it and batter him, people would have gone with it because they were so upset and so angry. But they wouldn't on reflection, and they wouldn't, and the trust of what the Icon Street campaign was about, making people see the connection between three elements, what we were trying to do. One was to identify the problem, to get local people to take some responsibility and to try and put moral pressure on anyone who will sell it, but also to lobby for the government change, and also, of course, to try and come up and say, okay, we're not just saying, here we are, we're giving you a model. This model might work. Because for those of you, I'm sure you know, with drugs, there isn't a solution to the drugs. There aren't simple solutions. Or maybe they're not, maybe you can do this, maybe you can do that, but it's a very complex problem everywhere in the world, and nowhere has dealt with it properly. But just to say how serious it was and how serious it remains, and I'm saying that because yesterday I'm on the National Drugs Strategy Group, which met yesterday, which is supposed to be finalising the report. And one of the things is, when you have, as it is, a group of 20 people from all the government departments and some people from drug users, like me, who are there representing community representatives and task force, is that the meeting tends to get divorced from the reality on the ground. In the North Inner City area at that time, there are gangsters who now, many years later, are very wealthy men who are shooting people and beating people up. Just last week, in one of the brand new £1 million redevelopment flats, a young woman was beaten up, viciously beaten up, because she owed about £1,000 for drugs. Did that get reported to the police? Of course it didn't. The shooting later on was on the news, and the shootings last year, which I'll talk about later, were on the news. So the drugs issue, outside of the huge social, emotional and personal thing it caused to individual families, in areas like this, the state has, in my opinion, really failed the communities in terms of dealing with the criminality and antisocial behaviour bit, and they've been very slow in coming. So ICON was doing its three-way thing. That was all happening, and it was also happening in other parts of Dublin. And again, there's another group, if you want to look up Citywide, which is just Citywide Drugs Crisis Campaign. They have a lot of information, a lot of background stuff that's on the net, on the internet too, that you could look up about it. Another group called the Coalition. Coalition of Communities Against Drug, COCAD. We're all doing that on a Dublin-wide basis, what ICON was doing with the North Inner City. And eventually, October 1996, and this is a report you should have a look at, if only for the introduction. In October 1996, and again, early March 1997, Pat Rabbit, who was within the government of the day, which was, again, a change government, it was the Fine Gael Labour Workers' Party, or Democratic Left, and Pat Rabbit was the Democratic Left at the time. So it was a three-party coalition, and he did it. And what was amazing about his report was, in my experience of reading government reports, that he introduced it by saying, you know, for many people in the communities where heroin is a thing, life is nasty, brutish, and short. Which is a quote that I'm sure you all know from Hobbes, the English political philosopher. He admitted how serious it was, and in the second report, he unequivocally made it clear that the government was completely getting it wrong. That is, for those of you who like to study, that is extremely rare in Irish political policy papers. They never admit they're wrong. They never, you know, they never say about it. So he did. So that was one thing that was there, that he admitted that. And then he tried to reach out to COCAD and Citywide and ICON, all the community groups, and he came up with a national strategy based, using as a model, what we had tried to develop in the North Inner City, and we'd be promoting and pushing over many years. A model of saying that if you want to address the drugs problem, what have you got to do? One, you've got to say the drugs problem, and you will probably have, the drugs problem is the same everywhere. It's not the same everywhere. It's different. It's much more different in areas like here, South Hill and Limerick, or Moyross, or whatever, or the inner city of Dublin, or Tallaght, or Ballyfermot, or Mayfield and Cork. It's much more different than anywhere because of the associated economic and social. And what's driving the drug push and what's driving young people into this is often not so much the drugs per se, but the social and economic inequality within those areas. That was recognized by Rabat, who was at the core of the approach. So to say, number one, you have to engage in those communities. Number two, there has to be proper stakeholder involvement. Number three, there has to be a kind of an evidence base to what you're doing, in the sense that you don't just rush off and say. And that's an interesting thing, if you want to look at drugs policy. Dublin Corporation had the Lord Mayor, who unfortunately the poor man is dead now, but was typical of Ireland's policy approach. For many, many years, particularly due to AIDS and HIV, and the medical profession decided that they could no longer accept the huge amount of harm that was been done. So they introduced harm reduction, i.e. through methadone and needle exchange and stuff like that. For years, even though that was Ireland's policy, that was denied, and the government said, no, we're a prohibition, we don't approve of that, blah, blah, we don't do harm reduction and so forth, for years. Dublin Corporation at one stage, under Brendan, who was a kind of a diplomat, is a nice kind way of saying, there are two protocols in Europe, or there were. The Frankfurt Protocol, which is for the liberal harm reduction side, and the Stockholm Protocol, which was for the, you know, no methadone, no harm reduction, abstinence, etc., etc. They're completely different philosophical approaches. I think Dublin was the only city that affiliated to both, which was a great achievement because that was for and against at the same time, which is kind of unique. Anyway. So by then, it was also about saying, let's look what works and so forth. And he put in place a very simple structure that I've yet to see match. So you had a cabinet committee in drugs chaired by the Taoiseach and the relevant ministers. You had a national drug strategy below it, and you had local and regional task forces. On the national drug strategy, you had community sector involvement. I happen to be one representing some of the community groups. And there was voluntary sector representatives from people from Merchants Quay, which are one of the foremost groups dealing with pain. And the local drugs task forces, you had about 12 or 13 people with six community reps and so forth. And they were set up and they were backed. There was a group set up, the National Drug Strategy Team, to review the plans. 90% of what was proposed by the task forces was funded. So there was a period about 3 or 4 years when Ireland's drugs policy was probably the most community development led and the most effective in Europe. And gradually, due to the economic cutback, plus a kind of a philosophical movement away from partnership and the involvement, it gradually unfolded, and that's another story. But again, what I'm saying is that when groups of people on the ground, ordinary workers and youth projects, linked in with community people, residents living in the area, linking in with academics, etc., came and set up a network and tried to address the issue in a coherent way. It did have an impact, and it did ultimately, along with the political pressure that was there by COCAD and by Citywide throughout the city, it did bring about change. However, you might then throw back at me that the RIA and I would agree with you, going back to what I said about Tony Gregory. It wasn't the rationale, it wasn't the thing. What brought about the change, what brought about, well, maybe not Pat Rabbits, but the government that he was part of's change of heart, was that Veronica Guerin, who was a high profile journalist, was shot dead by drug dealers on a public highway. And when people saw that throughout the country, naturally enough, the whole country was outraged, as they rightly should have been. My argument is that they should have been outraged that the years and years of people who have been intimidated, people who have been shot in poor marginalised areas, people who are living with all this. But the death of Veronica Guerin, combined with the action and combined with the fact that the medical profession was saying that unless we deal with this, did bring about social change. And again, my argument would be that the community development approach, people coming together, organising, building up a campaign, did help bring about a much coherent approach to the drugs issue. It's a bit unraveled, and again, hopefully we can build it up again. But that's sort of going from the 80s into the 90s. And I'll stop there. How are we on time?
We're tight enough in terms of time. So maybe the third bit.
Quickly.
Yeah.
Okay.
Great.
Well,
no,
Ireland because.
I just loved it, but
yeah. Okay. Ireland because of the fact that it's a changed country. In Ireland, I started working in the Neighbourhood Youth Project in 1979, all the kids were from the North Inner City, all the kids were white, all the kids were traditionally Catholic. You go back to the NYP now, and over the last 10 years, 12 years, we've done exchanges to Germany, and the Irish group used to be 15 young people, boys and girls, all Irish. Last year we went, and it was about 50-50, so 50% were Irish, and 50% were from all over the world. Some of them were from China, some of them from Mauritius, some of them from Africa, all over. Massive change. Why did it happen? How did it happen? Well, and as we all know, we became a wealthy country. There was a policy that we needed, and we needed basically cheap sources of labour. Not much at all went into the whole process, except from the economic side. And we then had a whole issue in relation to the fact that increasing numbers of young people were coming into areas like the North Inner City. We went into the school from the NYP because we were working with kids who had needs, or kids had problems with their family, or kids had problems. But when we went into schools, all of a sudden we saw that in the schools, 30%, 40% of some of the inner city schools were young people from outside of Ireland. And we said, well, why aren't they in the NYP? Because obviously they must, the same percentage must have the same type of needs. There must be kids with drugs problems. There must be kids with mental health. The same proportion, why aren't? And it was because there was nobody going out to try and bring them in. So there was a group set up called White Park, which is Young People at Risk, and there was a subcommittee that I chaired called FN White Park, which is Foreign National Young People. And over the last couple of years, it's tried to link in with all the international kids in the local schools and bring them into the youth services and look at the issues. We've had 5 or 6 residential conferences and day conferences where we talk to those young people, we see what their issues are. The issues, of course, are complex. The issues the same as with Irish kids, except they've got issues about their own culture. They have issues about, some of them might be Muslim kids, particularly the girls, and some of the stuff that's happening in Ireland is problematic for them. Even going away on trips is sometimes problematic. We have issues about racism. We have issues about the fact that they're not all the same. People would see them all the same, but they're not. We've got asylum seekers. And we've got unaccompanied children in care who come into the country and we're in the help of. We've got people who are here from the EU and are entitled. We've undocumented. We were looking at families, and this kid kept coming into us every day. He wouldn't leave till the place closed. When we then discovered that he was living in one of the most appalling, bad rented accommodation, and his mother got sick and they had no money and they were starving, and the mother couldn't go to the hospital. She was undocumented, she was afraid, etc, etc. We got a circular saying we're not supposed to deal with undocumented, and we said we're not. Of course we are, because it was our even within our constitution and our UN commitments. So we fought, but basically we had the scenario where the network found that there didn't seem to be sufficient policy. So again, just as with the drugs, what we've tried to do is that we've tried to reach out to the young people who are from outside of Ireland. We've tried to see what their needs are in the context of how we can work with them. And we've tried to do some integration between our own young people and them. Now, that is not easy. the fact that the MIP went from being all Irish to mixed was a long, long battle. Our kids berated us, berated me, called me all kinds of names I couldn't tell you. Were very racist, many of them, in their views. It took a long struggle of education and meeting to get to the stage where that would happen. And it wasn't, of course, the Irish kids, because we had some Romanian guys who came into us, and we had Roma kids, and they said, "What are you doing? What the Christ do you have these guys in there? You shouldn't let them in." And we had other guys saying, "You shouldn't have Africans." I mean, Chinese saying, you know, whatever. It was a real issue. But, of course, it was about looking at what the role of the MIP, looking at the name. And the question we were raised when we got together with the groups and we began to link the schools and link the youth projects, so now there is a link between the youth projects in town and the schools, that there's a higher ratio of kids from outside of Ireland involved in all those, in all the youth projects now, compared with other areas. We've gone out to other areas to show, but it took a long struggle of actually doing it. Then we also had issues about health, board and care. We had three young women from Africa in residential because they were in the care of the health board, and because of the economic cost of housing in Dublin, they closed down the hostel. They wanted to move one to Limerick, one to Galway and one to Sligo. We fought it because all the schools, the neighbourhoods, their friends were in Dublin. They'd been in Dublin for 3 years. They'd established, they were doing courses that weren't replicated maybe in Limerick. They didn't want to go. We fought, we took it to the court, we fought with the HSE. We lost, and the kids were moved. But we still fought it, and after a while, one of the kids got seriously ill in terms of mental health stuff, and eventually we got the kid back, and we got the projects in town to off their own bat without the support of the state agencies to support them, and they came back and they ran. But again, it was about looking at the issue, getting the key players locally, from the state, from the voluntary sector, as individuals to come together and to do it, and to do something about it. And then we also, of course, the other thing is the lobbying. We called in Frances Fitzgerald when she was Minister for Children, and Aidan O'Riordan when he was Minister with Responsibility for Integration, which was only a new thing. 10 years ago, the Fianna Fáil Green government had a Minister for Responsibility, two ministers, the one from the Green Party and then Conor Lennon. 10 years ago, we had a policy approach to trying to integrate. We've been trying to make the case, and we continue with a conference last week where we had about 40% young people, Irish and international, along with adults and people working. It was such an interesting one because